Good morning. Welcome back to Academy. Looking forward to today. I'm here myself, Josh, with Pastor Peter. And apparently, she was good enough that she was invited back. Oh,
thank you, Josh.
We're here with Brooke Lewis again. Oh, she was expecting this.
She knew that. She knew. I didn't expect anything less.
Yeah, no, we are so glad to have you, Brooke, and for part two.
Yeah.
Last week was amazing, and I just had fun. I was just sitting there. I'm just thinking about all the movie examples that are coming. Like, oh, this is cool. You know what I mean? So I was probably dazing off looking across the camera. But no, it was so exciting. Just how impactful and insightful it is. Who would have thought? That's the last one, I promise.
I doubt that.
No. Yeah, you're right. You know. No, we are excited. God's going to do, just like last week, He's going to move again today. And what Brooke's saying, what He's been revealing and building inside a book. And so listen intently, you know, write these things down. Don't let it be something that just remains here. Yeah. Don't go, oh, that's just good information, or that's a good principle, or that's in the Word. You know, receive it in your heart, and don't let it stay here. Yeah. Apply it to your life, because there's keys to victory here.
Yeah, amen. Definitely. And so, hi, everybody. And I'm very excited for this concept. It's because it's something a little bit new and different, in the sense of it's come from a different world that I know through acting, but then it's given us insight into things which are biblical and given us a perspective that enables us to grab hold of it.
That's right.
The Bible says in the book of Ephesians that we are to take off our old manner of life, renew the mind, and put on the new. And what that talks about is the fact that we are brand new in Christ. We're a brand new creature.
Yeah.
Jesus has worked His wonderful miracle working power, and we are born again, born of God. The Holy Spirit's come in, and that's just wonderful. But then it says you have to take off the old and put on the new, which talks about doing it on purpose.
Yep.
It talks about renewing the mind, which means it's a different way of looking at ourselves and life and everything around. What it tells me is that the new life is not just automatic.
Yeah.
Okay, it's in there, but we've got to allow it and get it to work out of our lives.
That's good.
And so that's why this is important, because this is talking about when you come in to do an acting role, and something that you just think you can just do normally, you suddenly find you're all awkward and you can't do it, because you don't realize the things that just come naturally to you. And these eight steps talk about all the things that are just naturally part of your life, but you're not doing them on purpose. They just happen. You know what I mean? It says, who am I and where am I? The first two that we started with last week.
What time is it?
What time is it? Yeah. Who am I and what time is it? They're just things like, I don't have to think about that when I'm being me.
Yeah.
And because they just happen. But when I'm trying to play a role, and like we said, you know, you see it when someone's just trying to be an extra, and who someone is not trained in acting, they just say, oh, I can be an extra. I can walk down the street and drink a cup of coffee. And you just suddenly find you can't do anything. I'm having a drink. I'm having another sip. And, you know, and it just looks just wrong.
Yeah.
It doesn't look right. And they're trying to talk to people in the back room, and they're glancing over sideways, and like, I'm being watched by the camera. As soon as you put a camera on, people behave differently. And that factor is like, well, hang on a second. This should be normal.
Yeah.
But it's not normal.
Yeah.
And I think that's what it is. This should be our normal life in Christ, but it needs us to work it out on purpose.
Yeah.
And the same way is you, when you're in front of the camera, need to be able to bring all these factors to say, this is actually who you are, and this is all the factors. We take this out in Christ, this is who I am, but I need to on purpose bring them in so they become natural to me. And so, you know, obviously acting is acting. What we're doing is releasing that which is in us that Christ has done, but we need to on purpose make the changes so that it comes out, and we put off the old and put on the new. Because the old man, it likes to come back in comfortable. You know, your old man's a little bit like those comfy slippers. You know, you feel good. You know, you behave. This is how I've behaved my whole life, and I can go back to it. And I say, no, I need to put on the new. And whilst you do that, it can be a little bit uncomfortable, a little bit like, you know, I like what Brother Jerry describes it as, the turning the canoe around.
Yes.
You know, and when you're halfway around, it's, you know, it's all, it was wobbly.
Yeah.
But then when you turn around, hey, this is my new life. And when you get in the groove of who you are in Christ, and you're released, yeah, it is flowing naturally. We don't have to sit there and do these things every day, like, oh, I've got to think about these things. What we're doing is retraining our mind that this is who we are, and then we get into the groove of it. Yeah. And then when we're in the groove of it, when the old man comes along and says, that's not natural. Behaving like the old person, that's
natural.
That's weird. What's, I don't do that.
I don't know. I feel like I've heard this somewhere, and it could be totally inaccurate, and if it's inaccurate, it's not going to work what I'm saying. So I'm just like, I'm just going with it.
Yeah.
Like, but is it with extras that they say the word like rhubarb or something?
Yeah, that's what I've always heard, that the word rhubarb, it goes in when in the background. Yeah. It doesn't actually sound like a word. It just sounds like muttering rhubarb. in the conversation.
But it makes it look like it's natural.
Yeah.
And when you, well, pastors just say like, rhubarb. We feel a bit silly, but we keep saying rhubarb, and then you get to this point, like, it looks...
Yeah,
but
then it looks really natural.
That's right. That's correct. Like, rhubarb.
Yeah. I saw this great behind-the-scenes clip. I don't even remember which movie it was from, but they had a scene where the main guy's just walking through the city going to a meeting, and they show the... while before they say action... and there's all these hundreds of extras around the city block all just standing. And then they say action, and then everyone starts walking. And they say things you don't think about when there's hundreds of people. Yeah. Everyone is perfectly placed.
Ready to go.
And then everyone's just standing there waiting in the street about to walk. And they're like, okay, 3, 2, 1, action. And then everyone just starts to move at once. Yeah. And it was amazing. Go, okay, wow. It's so fake, but it looks so real.
Yeah.
So what our aim is to get to the real away from the fake.
Yeah, exactly.
Is that who we are. Actually, let me just call it up because, you know, this is Bible Academy. So, so Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 22. It's on King James, by the way. Because I had a discussion after last week's Bible Academy. I was actually able to have a chat with our guest speaker for next week, Greg Baker, and we were talking about some scriptures, and he was referring to something, and I was calling it up, and we were having a look on the King James for a particular translation.
Oh, that's amazing. So exciting.
We'll talk more about that at the end, but we're pretty exciting. But I'm not often reading the King James, but there was a reason for it last week. He doesn't use the King James. He does use the King James, but... not exclusively. I feel like I'm... Okay. You were taught, Ephesians 4:22, you were taught with reference to your former way of life, lay aside the old man who is being corrupted in accordance with deceitful desires, to be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and to put on the new man who has been created in God's image, in righteousness and holiness that comes from truth.
Yeah. Mm.
So this is our new man. This is who we are. This is us from the core.
Yeah.
So we're not trying to... act or imitate like the new person. We are the new person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to act like a child of God. I am God's child. I am a son of God. But that new responsibility comes to me, and I've got to learn how to walk in it and how to release it and how to activate it.
That's right. Yeah.
And it says there that you were taught. You've got to put aside the old way. It's not, that part is not natural. Our old, Jesus has renewed us on the inside, but it doesn't mean that our old ways have just disappeared.
Yeah.
Our life is putting that to death, getting rid of that. And you do that through the renewing of the spirit of the mind, the way you think, and then you put on this new way. So these 8 steps that we're talking about here are actually this process.
Mm.
They're helping us to look what is a person. What are all the things that feed into them? So as a new man, what are the 8 things that feed into us as a new man? And it really helps us to do this on purpose so that we can train ourselves and equip ourselves. This is who I am. And then we can get into the natural mind and that's just who we are.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I know for me, where this concept kind of really came alive in my heart was early this year. And there was a challenge I was facing. A storm of life had arisen. And frankly, I just felt completely overwhelmed and I felt so confused. I knew God wanted victory for me. Mm. I knew that God promised victory for me. I knew victory was on the other side, but I just did not know how I could walk through it. And it reminded me of when I first studied acting and I'd see actors play these amazing roles and it would feel so real. and I would try to imitate them, and it wouldn't work. And I would think, how can they do this craft so well? How can they use their bodies, their voices, everything about them, their emotions to affect me through a screen, and yet I'm trying to imitate it and it's not working? And in the same way that it really helped when I found Howard Fine's 8 steps, where it means, okay, don't even focus on how you're going to do it in front of camera. Don't focus on the end result. Don't focus on how you're going to say those lines.
Yeah.
Go back to these 8 foundational steps, work through those steps, and by the time you get to step 8, you will already be en route for how you're going to really say those lines.
Yeah, that's good.
And that's why God really used that for me. He said, okay, do the same thing. He said, don't focus on how you're going to get through this storm. Don't focus on how you're going to pray in faith. Don't focus on saying, should I praise? Should I worship? Should it be a really strong roar, or should it just be lifting my hands? Should I be praying for myself? Should I be praying for someone else? Should I sow a seed? Don't focus on how you're going to get through this storm. Just take a step back, go through these 8 steps.
Mm.
And by the time I got to the step number 8, the storm was not overwhelming, and the storm did not overwhelm me, because now I had such a better foundation for who I am in Christ, how God is writing my story, where I am with God. Yeah. And suddenly, instead of thinking, I need to make sure I do the perfect thing, I need to pray the perfect prayer in order to get an answer, it was suddenly like, you know what, I'm so confident, I'm just going to pray and see what happens, because I know that God's got me.
Mm.
And for Howard Fine, he says, as an actor, if you do these 8 steps correctly, he said, then you can actually enjoy the fun of acting, because he said you can sort of just create. And so he always says, don't plan how you're going to deliver lines. He says, don't ever go through and say, okay, I'm going to yell this line here, and okay, I'm going to actually take a pause and then deliver this line. He said, don't work out how you're going to do it.
Mm.
He said, never work out how. He said, always look at the why, look at the who, look at the where, take all the steps back.
And then it'll come naturally.
And then he said, then it comes naturally. He said, that's when you can get an amazing performance, because it's someone has actually connected to a fictional character,
I'm not saying these scriptures because, oh, I'm just echoing. Pastor said to say these scriptures. So I am saying these scriptures. Do I say them loud? Do I say them soft? How do I say these scriptures? No, you find out these 8 steps and who you are. And then out of that, you're saying the scriptures.
Exactly. And in acting, he said that the exciting thing is when you're acting and suddenly you do something you hadn't even expected, and suddenly you scream a line out, which you always thought would be a whisper, but it just, in that moment,
it felt right
and good. Actually felt connected to the role. It felt connected to the words. And so you scream it out. And he says, those are the amazing parts in film, in theater, when the whole room goes quiet, because it's like someone's just done something amazing and sort of someone is connected to something in the story. Or how much more is it for us when we're halfway through a prayer? And I know we've felt it when you're in a prayer meeting, you're at a convention, you're at church, and suddenly someone does something and it's like everyone goes quiet because you know God is moving in this place. That suddenly someone on stage sings out a song which we hadn't planned, and it's like everyone stops going, God is working. Mm. Something is happening here. Someone is praying a prayer and they flip into that point where you go, oh my goodness, God is in this place.
Yeah, that's good.
And I think, for me, that's where this whole 8 steps happened, was using the 8 steps I've always used from Howard Fine for acting and saying, if I do the same thing, now I don't need to worry how I'm going to get through the storm. It's going to come naturally because I'm actually coming from this foundation of who I am in Christ, of where I am, of what time it is, all the different steps. And then I don't have to think about the how, it will just flow from that. Yeah.
So we started last week.
There's Howard Fine, who wrote the 8 steps.
And the first one we look at, who am I? And that's the foundational one. That's really, really strong. Yeah. Not characteristics, but actually who am I in the core. And then we looked at what time is it. I thought that was really clever because most people don't think about time.
No.
But it was like, oh, I'm in the middle of this prophetic word. I'm in the middle of this season that God has proclaimed to be this. That really was very helpful. To see myself not just as a person here, but in the midst of some sort of time, some sort of era.
I think that was, just real quickly, I thought that was really interesting because for me, I hadn't really thought of, like you were saying, I haven't really thought about that.
Mm.
And so whatever it is that you're going through or that God's promised, that's added like a new dimension for people to actually like, oh, what time is it?
Yeah.
And that might be the answer. Like that might be what you need.
Yeah.
So
that was really cool to hear that.
And then, so number three, we're up to.
Where am I?
And if you need to review that, you know, we spent more time on the overall concept and step one and two, obviously, last week. So you can go to our website, breakthrough.org.au, /academy. All our past messages there. You can also go, some people don't realize this, but you can also go to podcasts.
Yeah.
So Apple Podcasts. We have a channel on there. Sometimes listening to a podcast is easier.
Yeah.
It works really well with your phone and in the background and things like that. So we're actually, our Breakthrough Academy is on Apple Podcasts. Or you can go to the YouTube channel, Breakthrough Melbourne, and find out all our messages there as well. So lots of avenues to go to where we were and what we've done. But we're up to now step number three. Where am I?
Well, yes.
Look, can I just say, some of these things are, you think they're so basic, you say, I don't need to answer that. But you do, because what you do is, most people can answer, where am I, as the old man, without thinking. You know, that's just who I am.
Yeah.
I just know where I am.
Yeah.
But no one talking about where you are in your old man, because that's just what the part that you do naturally.
Mm.
We're looking at, where am I in Christ? Where am I, with that person sitting? Because that one you need to put on purpose.
Yeah.
And that's also where God sees you
is
different to what you would say that.
Yeah.
So it's like, that doesn't match up.
That's a really good point. You know, sometimes, you know, we say, if you ask them, where are you? And then you gave the answers, God's like, that's not where you are.
Yes. Yeah, how many times are we answering these eight steps, but then God says, those are not the right answers? Go back to the Word of God and redo these answers.
We've got some, you know, we've got Christine saying, I'm in Winterna South. Yeah, that's exactly what we meant. And hi to all the people. We've got Judith, my wife Christine, and Brooke's mum Christine, Kylie, Joe Rose, and of course Sheba, Richard. We've got people watching.
Yeah,
so
amazing.
Shout out to all those that have put comments
in. And I would love to say, before we even start looking through these steps, if you have a favorite movie or a favorite movie character, can you please put them in the comments? Because we'll be trying to, a lot of the examples we'll use, we'll go back to movies to help you understand where the concept actually was formed and then how we can apply it to the Word of God.
Yep.
But it's always fun. If there's movies that you love, it's more fun to then include those rather than us just talking about our favorite movies. But what would your two favorite movies be for you two gentlemen?
Hmm.
So we can start.
I got to think of one that you've also seen.
Yeah.
Sometimes movies are a little bit scary for Brooke.
Just a little bit.
I'm thinking my favorite horror.
I love all of the Star Wars, any of the Lord of the Rings. I don't know if there's one. Okay. If there's one that you.
No, okay, good. We can use that. That's enough. We can go from there. Do you have one, Pastor Peter, or?
Well, yeah. As a child, Star Wars was always like, wow, this is like a new level of movie.
Yeah.
They're very original.
That's true.
To me, it wasn't Episode 4.
Yeah.
It
was just, well, what it's about just Star Wars.
I might. Maybe I'll also mention a movie that I do like. Maybe that someone else likes. The Hunger Games. Would there be some good ones there, maybe?
Just a little bit. The Hunger Games always has a soft spot in my heart, because that was the movie where I watched the movie and became fascinated and obsessed with the making of it.
Mm.
And so more than the movie, I've watched the making of the movie I don't know how many times. And so that was the movie which sort of got me into the whole behind the scenes of how films are created and everything. So that was big special.
I say this, this is looking here. It's
Absolutely Sakai.
Yes.
That's a good movie.
That's a great movie.
I'll admit that.
And Jasmine Wong is joining us at Hunger Games. I'm in Baronia. I'm in the lounge room. Richard. Yeah. This question is like, duh. And that's how people read. Now, if you said, you got to know where you are.
Yeah.
Everybody's like, that's just so obvious. I don't
know.
You know, for us, we're sitting here in the studio in the church. It's just like, duh. This is just... Yeah. This is the question you shouldn't have to ask. It's almost like, if I have to ask, where am I?
Mm.
That's a concussion test.
How many fingers am I holding up?
That's like, you're not thinking straight if you can't answer this.
Yeah.
It should be just something very normal. So this is why these questions are so important, because we would brush them off and say they're not necessary. They're silly questions. They're basic questions.
What's the relevance
to that? Why do I need to know where am I? It's because in your natural self, this is so ingrained. You don't even think about it. It's just who you are. It's just what you do. You don't even have to give any thought to it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But when you come to putting on the new man, you have to put it on purpose because otherwise you bring the where am I from your old life.
Yeah, exactly.
And you don't know to get rid of it.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? True. You don't even realize there's a where am I aspect to you. You need to put that off. That's not where you are.
Yeah.
But when you say, well, where am I? So I'm guessing people are saying, well, where am I?
Yeah.
If I can't answer in the lounge room, in Boronia, in Australia, if I can't answer that, what is my answer?
Yeah.
So, Brooke, help
us. So the thing that Howard Fine teaches, because I thought the same thing when I first read these questions, what he does is he'll give you a scene and then he'll get you to answer. If you're in the lecture, then you sort of go through the questions. And what I found the first few times I did the lecture was I would be finished the questions in about 30 seconds and then realize everyone else is taking way longer. It's really obvious. It says, scene takes place day, diner. What time is it? Day, time, location, diner. I'm done. And then
I'm in a diner in the day.
Yeah. And then I sort of thought, why is no one else stopping writing? It's pretty obvious. We've gone through them. But what Howard Fine teaches, he said, we as humans, we are not neutral to space. And I'll use practical examples for this. I walk into our house and I'll go and I'll sit on the couch. I'll put the movie on. I will sit there. I'll put my legs up on the couch. I'll drink a coffee. I go to a friend's house and I go to their parents' house for the first time. And I will sit on the couch and I'll sit stiff and I'll make no noise. And I'll wait for them to say, oh, if you'd like to turn the TV on, of course, absolutely. And I will sit there.
And not often say, oh, no, I'm fine.
I'm fine.
I really want to watch what's on the TV, but no, I'm fine because I don't want to be seen to be doing something different.
Yeah, a true story. We went to a friend's house and there was a few of us from the church were there and we were so awkward meeting the family for the first time. So we're all sitting there and it was so cold and we're all sitting there like shivering, but no one wanted to say something. And then God bless Nadia. Finally, he spoke up and said something about, could we maybe turn the aircon down? And we're all saying, thank you. Like, we're all cold. I'm like, why are we scared to ask his parents to turn the aircon down? But we're just sitting here being like, we don't want to make a fuss. No, we're fine. Happy. And that's a funny example, but how I can read house in a script and there's two very distinct
ways. You're in a lounge room.
Yeah, it just says day lounge room. And I go, okay, it's the day I'm in a lounge room. Is this my lounge room or am I going to a lounge room of someone I've only just met? Because that will completely change how I relate to this this location. That will completely change who I am in this location. Brooke at my house is far more talkative than Brooke at a house where I am just trying to make sure I'm not making a fuss and I'll just sit there quietly. Yeah. It completely changes who you are. And Howard Fine uses a great example where he said, there was a scene some of his actors were working on and they would come in and they would do the scene. I think it was something like they were having a fight in the scene. So they would do the thing where they would have a fight, they would yell at each other. And he kind of stopped them and said, okay, where is this scene taking place? And they said, oh, okay, it's at a restaurant. And he said, have you ever gone to a fancy restaurant and rehearsed this scene? And they said, no. And he said, you are taking ownership of this table. You are yelling at each other about this fight. He said, this scene is specifically written to be in a restaurant because you now are so awkwardly aware that the room around you can hear. This is a fancy restaurant. He said, there are candles on the table. You can't just stand up and yell. He said, the scene is written in this conflict of you want to yell, but the location means you have to be looking like everything's fine to the waiters while you're telling each other what you think. And so he said, a great acting technique is take a scene like that and actually try to rehearse it in a restaurant because you will realize how the location is the most important thing in this situation.
Yeah, that's good.
Because now suddenly I say something snappy at you and I realize the table next to us stops talking and looks. And now I suddenly go quiet again.
Yeah,
exactly.
You're trying to do it, but
exactly.
In
covert, so or he said there was one scene where the mum runs in to tell her son good news. And so she runs in and the son sort of is like, oh, hi, mum, gives her a hug, talking to her, hearing the news, is so excited. And again, Howard Fine says, just remind me where this scene takes place. And he said, oh, okay, well, it takes place in the hospital where I work. And he said, okay, well, can we just stop and realize that you are at work, you're a surgeon, and your mother has just burst through the doors to tell news of her new job. And he goes, oh, Now suddenly I understand this scene is not about me just hearing the news. It's about my mum has come to my workplace in front of everyone to tell me this news about her job. And suddenly, instead of being, oh, hey, mum, yeah, come and tell me the news, it's a, why is my mum here? This is so embarrassing. I'm in front of my boss.
Let me just sew the patient up first, mum.
Yeah, just give me a second.
Just put the heart back in, yeah. Check that. All right.
Just a moment.
Tell us your news, yeah. Mum.
And when he was sharing those stories, I thought, I now understand why knowing the location is important, because the location really is another character in a scene.
Yeah.
And that's why when you're writing a screenplay, you will be so intentional about where you want scenes to take place.
Mm. Because it changes how you behave.
Exactly. If I'm writing a scene, I will write it very much in terms of where the location is. So how people should be talking to each other. Are there other people around? All these things. If as the writer, the character is, the one of the characters is the location. Yet as an actor, I think, oh, location, whatever. That doesn't matter. But you're going, no, actually, it does matter.
So how does that work? How does that switch over to the new me in Christ?
Well, so when I was looking at these questions, when God said for me, for this faith project, he said, don't feel overwhelmed, go to these 8 steps. And when I got to where am I kind of felt a bit stumped. I thought, well, I don't understand how that really, I don't understand how that plays into it. But God, I was like, I'm in earth. Okay, God, I'm going to be specific. I don't know what this means.
Yeah.
But God actually said, one of the main things he said to me, he said, okay, every scene in a film, it takes place in a location, and that location will be under someone's authority. So, okay, in the restaurant, the owner of the restaurant has the authority. So the couple having the fight, it is very much they have to be under...
Can I just say something? There's also the authority of what's expected to happen
in that place. Yeah. Yes.
You know what I mean? It's like, it's the unwritten rule in a restaurant and in a fancy restaurant, keep your voices down.
Yes.
You behave with a decorum, you behave appropriately. And that's like, you don't walk in and there's signs on the door.
Yeah.
This is a fancy restaurant. This is how you'll behave.
Yeah.
There's no set of rules how you'll behave. You know, obviously you get them nowadays, you know, you won't be rude to our...
Yes.
You won't be rude to our waiters and stuff, because people have got to be reminded of what basic rules are. But there's no real set of rules that you go to. Everyone just knows. Everyone in the restaurant understands this is the expected and required way to behave here. And that cultural expectation is like an authority.
Yes.
And if you step out of it, everybody like... What are you
this
doing?
Is not right. Exactly. And, you know, using the Hunger Games, that movie is filled with these points where it's in this location, you are here as just one of the 24, but you are expected to behave a certain way.
Mm.
And the whole film is that Katniss will do all these little things which make everyone in the room stop and stare because it's you don't do that here. This is, you can do that in your home. You can't speak that way. You don't have a right to speak up in this location.
Yeah.
And once again, the main character is actually the location because that is what determines the hierarchy. That's what determines who has the authority. And so when God spoke to me, he said, okay, do you believe you're taking this prayer scene and it's taking place in a location where the enemy has the authority, and so I'm here in the corner praying my prayer, but being like, I don't want the enemy to realize that I'm actually praying against this situation, and I'm just quietly mumbling while I'm eating my food, saying, God, I'm just declaring that you're going to work in this situation. Or is it actually, this is my lounge room, so I'm gonna lie down on the couch if I want. I'm gonna have a coffee. I'm gonna put the TV on because this is my lounge room.
My space.
And so I'm gonna stand up and I'm gonna shout out my prayer because this is where I have the authority. This is where I'm sorry. You know, people can come in and say, "Oh, that's not how you should behave." It's like, well, I'm sorry. This is my house. You can decide that in your house.
Yeah.
But no, this is what we do in this house. These are, you know, I love our house has this thing where it's like the rules. It's a sign we bought. It's like the rules of this family house. And so it seems like we'll always be nice to each other. It's all like this quirky little saying. But it's that concept. Someone comes in and says, I'm sorry, you can't be praying that faith here. You go, actually, I'm sorry. This is my house. Yeah. I have the authority. This is my life. Yeah. I have the authority in my life to speak out. The enemy does not have the authority over my life. The enemy does not have the authority over my joy, over my emotions, over my peace, over my mind. I'm sorry, these are my thoughts. Yeah, so no, actually, enemy. I don't have to try to come up with opposing thoughts to what you're trying to put in my head. It's like, actually, you have no right in this location. This is my authority. And yeah. Suddenly I read the scene and realize I'm actually the one with the authority in this place. And so now everything I say holds that greater weight because I realize at any point, you know, in a scene, that point, at any point I could kick you out.
Yeah.
And so there's that point where you can question me, but if you question me too much, I'm just going to kick you out of this location. We go at the enemy and say, actually, no, I'm just going to kick you out now because this is my authority.
Yeah,
it's my location.
I think of when Jesus was, Jairus said, come to my home, you know, and they said, don't bother, your daughter's dead. He said, let's go, stay in faith. And when they got there, everyone, you know, you got the professional mourners all crying and weeping, and Jesus kicked them out.
Yes.
And because he said, this is my space.
Yeah.
this is, now, it's sort of funny. It's funny when I see Jesus do it.
Yeah.
It's funny when I see Jesus do it because I it's like, that's not your space, but you made it your space.
Yeah.
You said, I'm here as the man of God. I'm here as as the representative of God here. I'm that's here. Good. And this is the space that's got, and it already said to Jairus, don't get into fear, only be believing.
Yes.
Don't be fearful, only be believing. You have to protect.
Yes.
You have to protect the same, it's the same, I don't know what that is called, the muscle, the organ, it's the same function of your spirit which fears is the same function which believes.
Yeah.
But fear is just the belief function in the wrong thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
All right, so when you're fearing, you're believing.
Yeah, you're believing something.
You're believing something, all right? You're just believing something that's making you have a negative reaction, but you're actually believing something. And so how can I... Okay, sometimes we think fearing and faith are two different things. Like, I can be listening to music whilst lifting weights.
Yeah.
Right? So I can be listening to music and lifting weights. And if I told you, don't be listening to music, only be lifting weights.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. You just want me to concentrate.
Yeah.
Right? You know, okay, don't do this, only do it. But I can do them at the same time.
Yeah.
You're just telling me not to. All right? No, what I'm saying is don't be lifting that weight. Be lifting this weight.
Yes, that's all good.
Right? You say, well, because you're not capable of actually lifting them at the same time. It's the same function. So Jesus is saying, if you're in fear, you cannot be in faith.
Exactly.
Because it's the same act. It's a corruption. Fear is a corruption of what was put in man by the Spirit. Yeah. It's just taking what was designed to put our trust in God, believe in God, just... to be in united with him. We were created with an ability to trust him. This is just, it's a part of our creation. It's the fact that we've been born, created in the likeness of God is an ability to believe.
Mm.
An ability to put our trust in it and rely upon someone and look to someone. And so Jesus used the phrase, now take my yoke upon you, which is really just a uniting of myself with you. And that's the yoke is a faith thing, you know.
Yeah.
It's I'm connecting myself with you. I'm putting myself in your hands. And then that was corrupted when they had the fall and they chose to disobey and they chose to become their own gods and say, no, we'll make the decisions here. God says this is not good. Well, we actually say it is good.
Yeah.
You know, this is good. This is good. And God said this is not good. No, we know. So we know what this is good. And we say, and by becoming something awakened in them, and suddenly they became fearful.
Yeah. Mm.
And so instead of their ability to say, oh, we can just trust God, they suddenly, we don't feel right. We've now put our trust in ourselves and a new thing has awakened in us.
Mm.
We've trusted in what the enemy has told us. And now we're awakened to something which is... So fear is a corruption of what was there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same muscle.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. So... when we trust in God. So Jairus was told, don't be fearing. You've got to use that muscle. You've got to stay.
Yeah.
You've got to be trusting me. You've got to be relying upon me. You can't do that. And so you can't just say, I will not fear. I will not fear.
Yeah.
No, it's like you got to let go of that weight, but you've got to pick up the other
weight.
You know, this is about focusing, leaning in. I am trusting. He had, what Jairus had to do was just look at Jesus and say, he's got it.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Okay, he's got this. Every time the servants were there, that, you know, they're in his ear. Don't bother him. She's dead. We've seen her. She's dead. We've seen her. She's dead. Okay, I'm focusing. Jesus said to trust him. I'm just relying on him. Yeah. I'm not listening to you guys. I'm not paying attention to you. You know, it actually says, the scripture there, it says when the servants came, the scripture is sort of beside put, you know, it's about, it can be translated two ways, and bless the Amplified Bible, translate it both ways. Because it's like, it means overhear from the side or hear something and put it to the side.
Yeah.
And I like to think Jesus heard what they said and moved to the side.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
It was like, I hear what they say, but
that's good.
We're not doing... And he said, Jairus, you need to do the same. You need to take what they've said and put it to the side. Now you need just to hear what I'm saying.
Mm.
Just stay in faith. So when Jesus gets there and the whole atmosphere is filled with fear, he's like, where am I?
Yes.
He says, I'm not in a fear place.
Yes.
Yeah,
this is not me. This does not reflect who I am. And he actually changed what was around him to match with where he was.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Where am I? I'm in a place of faith and I'm in a place of authority. So I'm actually changing this.
Exactly.
All right. I am rearranging the furniture.
Yeah.
This is not how my lounge room looks.
Yeah.
I live it because it's my lounge room and this is what I do. Mm. And, you know, the TV's on and it's got some program. I don't watch that program.
Yeah, exactly.
That's not what I do here. Yeah, I'm not feeling good. That's not the atmosphere I have around my ear. They're listening to that music. I don't want that, you know.
Yeah.
I don't want that stuff on. You know, and in fact, I'm going to put on my music. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
A little Brown Lake to bop along to. And this is where I am. This is my environment.
Yep.
Mm. This is who I am.
Yep.
This is what God has called me to be.
Yes.
And I'm not just the result of what the world. And there's a movie. We had a couple of extra movie suggestions up there. And Richard said anything with the word Trek in it.
Star
except,
Trek.
Except Beyond.
That's a lot of them.
Except Beyond. I don't know why. Am I triggering him? Say Beyond's my favorite. anyway, number 8's my favourite in Star Wars. You know,
that's wrong.
That's chicken people. And we had Wonka.
Great movie.
Put up there. Another movie I'm thinking of is one, the one where they spin the top.
Inception.
Inception.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
All right, that's
mind.
If you want to move,
is it still
messes with you know, is it, you know, with how you what's real, what's not in terms of they use dreams for people not they learn how to control dreams.
Yeah.
They can enable and make people have dreams, and then use those dreams to plant ideas.
Yes.
Because you know, and so and then when they wake up, they think the ideas come from themselves, so they'll do it. So they create dreams, but someone's got to actually create the dream.
Yeah.
So they have people that are like the dream creators.
Yes.
And they have they call the architect, which creates the space for that dream. And they said something happens. I can't remember what it is. I can't remember the movie that clearly, but everybody starts looking at you if you do something wrong.
Yeah.
If you start using a location which you actually have seen in real life, a real life.
Yeah.
Architecture can't be used in a dream,
and everybody starts to get agitated.
Yeah,
and so you know, so and it's like you're in that restaurant and you start behaving. Everybody turns.
Yes.
Their head. Everybody so focuses on you. You become like, this is not normal.
Yeah.
I'm going against the flow. This is not what I should do. You got to be ready for that.
Yeah.
Because where you are, you're going to be in places where you're not doing. You're not in the flow with the world.
Yeah,
anymore.
Exactly. Yes.
You're not doing the Jesus, like he went to the place and they're all Jesus didn't cry. He said, we're gonna raise her up, and they begin to laugh at him.
Yeah.
It's gone, you know, so much for this you fool. You know, they it wasn't real. But he became the object of scorn. They turned on him.
Yeah.
They turned on him.
Yeah.
And that's a fear factor that we have, that if I start to create my space around who I am in Christ and what God's told me, I get the world will say that's not the right way to do, and actually can pressure us and can say don't behave like that. I have example. I have in even though there was no one there, except you know me, Jay and Josh.
Yeah.
We were there when Jay fell off the top of the waterfall and landed, and his ankle went sideways, and we were praying. there is an expected way to respond to that circumstance.
Yeah.
All right? There's just, this is how you respond. You know what I mean? There's a bit of, okay, we don't panic. We've got to, you know, don't panic.
A great quote from a TV show I watched this week when the girl's like, okay, don't panic. And her sister says, does anyone ever say that unless there's a reason to panic? She said, no one says that unless there's a genuine reason to panic.
Yeah. Don't be fearful. Don't look on your shoulder.
Yeah, exactly. So don't panic. Okay.
It wasn't until you said that.
Yeah. You look at the last chapters of Deuteronomy and Joshua, it says, fear not. God, can you... What's ahead?
Yeah, exactly.
What's ahead? Because you can don't fear. Don't be fearing. Okay. And you know, it's like there's an expected way. The first way, you know, don't panic. We've got to stay calm. We've got to stay level headed. We've got to do this because there's an expected level, but there's an expected way to behave. Yeah. Now we've got to we've got to think. What do we do? We've got to call 911. We've been in America. Call 000.
Yeah.
You know, we've got to do this. Got to do that. There's an expected way to respond. It's like, oh, I can't, I'm going to be getting in fear. Now we've got to squash the fear. We've got to be professional about this. You know, they're all natural responses. Yeah. They're natural. Yeah. Even the squashing the panic in order to take care.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
Like, got to rise up. We've got to do the right thing here. You know, I've got my first aid training. All those things which are good.
Yeah.
But they're, where am I in this world?
Yes, exactly.
And I really, really appreciate when... when Jay said something, he changed where we were.
Wow, that's so powerful. All right?
And he said, guys, let's pray.
Yeah.
He said, we have been so pumped in, we have been filling ourselves with the word and with the presence. We're driven just up the sea. And we've just been filling ourselves with expectation. We've been talking the word. And he's like, you know what? Let's not forget where we are.
Yeah. Mm. Amen.
Okay. That's, and that's really got good. Nothing to do with we're at the bottom of a waterfall in cold water. That's... We are not in this world's way of dealing with this.
Yeah.
We are not in this world's expected way to respond.
Yeah.
We are in a different zone, and we turn to God in these moments.
Yes.
And it was a little bit. And there was, and actually I say there was no one there. People came.
Yeah.
And we had hikers come, and we're praying in tongues.
Wow.
And we're laying on hands. And at this point, Josh, were you aware of people around?
Not at the start. I noticed them after, and they were looking.
Yeah. It's like, what are you doing? And there's a pressure on you to behave like a normal person would behave. Oh, he's broken his ankle. Can you call 000? No, we're behaving very differently.
Yes. No, it was very different, yeah.
Yeah, we're not doing the normal.
Yeah.
And it's like, even though there's... And it's funny how you feel... If we were doing the normal thing, telling everybody.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't want to say what we're doing because... They're saying, well, why are you still sitting down there?
Yeah.
Why are you still in the water?
Because we are praying. Because we are seeking God. That's why. And so I'm not going to tell you what we're doing because it's going to be, you know, well, why are you doing that? Why are you doing
it? It would have made us think about it. Oh, maybe we should do that.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. It puts you into their mindset.
And what Jay gave us, opened the door and said, I want us to remember where we are, boys. Come on. And that gave us freedom to say, okay, because if the person says, and if I say, can I pray? Yeah, but can you get me first? And can you ring this first? And I need this first. Yeah. And can you, prayer is what we do after we've done all the normal stuff. You know what I mean?
Once you've done all the things in the natural, then you start praying.
I haven't got, but Jay sort of gave us permission in a very serious situation. He said, okay, guys, I know what we normally do, but he said, let's go to prayer.
And he said,
I want you to come. And it's like, you can go to prayer with me. And basically what we did, we pushed out the mourners.
Yeah.
We pushed out the people that are going to behave in a certain way. And we became focused on what we were going to do. And you got to remember where you are. And that's like, it's a location has expectations.
Yeah, exactly.
Where you are in the natural has an expected way to behave.
Yeah.
And when you go different, you've got to remember where you are.
Yes.
And what your position is.
And I feel that's one of the things with Howard Fine's teaching, where suddenly I realized, all these times I've just gone, okay, first word I see, you know, take this scene, diner, I just go diner and move on. I realize I am missing out on so much richness to this scene, to this character, because suddenly, and one of the things he always says, he says, you want to endow the space with memories. Okay, if this is your lounge room in a film, he said, okay, every family, no one knows why, but everyone always sits at the same place every night when we watch TV. Everyone has your seat on the couch. Everyone has your seat at the dining table. He said, everyone will have the one cup they always use. And he said, no one knows why, but it's just a thing in life. We're creatures of habit. We always sit.
Okay, ask people, you go to church.
Yeah.
You can sit anywhere. Where do you sit?
The same spot every week. And suddenly, okay, yeah, using church as an example, you walk in and go, okay, this scene takes place at church. You go, okay, well, it's a church. I just walk in. No, I'm sorry, but okay, if we say the scene is going to be this Sunday, you're going to film the scene where you're going to press in for a miracle and a turning point, and that's the scene you're preparing for Sunday morning, you realize, okay, this scene's taking place in this church. Okay, I look around at this church, and what am I seeing? I'm seeing memories of other miracles.
Mm.
I'm suddenly seeing seats where I think of the people who sit on those seats and the miracles that they've experienced.
Yeah.
I look up and I think of the miracle that this facility is.
Mm.
I suddenly remember the time Brother Jerry was on that stage and he imparted favor into our congregation. Mm. And suddenly this, once again, this location becomes another character which you can actually draw strength from. You can draw inspiration from. And so you go, okay, instead of me focusing on how am I going to pray on Sunday so I can see a miracle in the situation,
mm.
you suddenly actually draw strength from the very location, from these memories. You want to, and that's why he said, in a fictional story, he said, you want to have those same memories for all of these things. Because he said, that's how you will reach yourself. That's how you will connect emotionally to these characters.
Mm.
When suddenly you pick up a cup and you've already created this memory of, okay, this is the cup that I've always used since I was a kid. And you start creating in your head all the different family dinners when you've used this cup. Because he said in real life, that is what happens.
Yeah.
All these things hold memories. All these things hold stories. And so as actors, he said, you go to a film set, you go to a theater, and he said, your job is to then take the basic work that the set designer would have given you and then try to add in all the other things that will help you connect to that character. And so as Pastor Peter just said, okay, I look at my life and say, I've got this life, but what are the little tweaks I can make which help me to fully connect to my place being a place of faith?
Mm-hmm.
So is it a, okay, and I watched an amazing masterclass with Helen Mirren, who's amazing. And she literally did a long masterclass on this very topic where she walked into a set which they had pre-prepared for her to be her home. They gave her a fictional character. And then for like an hour, you just watched her reading over her character and making tweaks to her house to help her further connect with the character. And by the end of it, it was like a totally different set because you go, I can't believe this is a set. This just feels so real. And it was all the little tweaks. She'd go, okay, my character is a detective, not married, no family. I've just moved here 12 months ago. She says, this lounge room is far too pretty for someone who is obsessed with their job. So she went out and made little changes. Like she took out all the pretty cushions and put in the most basic pillows, which were comfy because she said, okay, yeah, my character, I didn't have time to go shopping to get all the pretty little things. My character, it's the basics. It's a, okay, this couch. No, I have a couch which I often end up sleeping on because I'm working late. And she made all these tiny little changes to the room. And suddenly by the end of the masterclass, you fully believe this is actually the lounge room of a detective.
Yeah.
Because all of these little things tell this story. And it's that same challenge for us. It's sort of taking a stock take of our lives and saying, is this actually an environment of faith, my life? And sometimes it is the little tweaks. It's a, okay, you know what? This music, I'm sorry, a detective would not be listening to this music. A detective wouldn't, that's not what a detective would listen to. So I make a tweak and I go, yes, this is the music of faith. This is what I should be listening to. Yes, these sermons. Yes, I put scriptures up on my fridge to help me. And it's sort of creating, even in the physical world, creating a space which will actually be speaking to us and we constantly reinforcing that message of faith for where we are. And one of the things he talks about for where am I, he always says you have to provide for yourself what's beyond the fourth wall.
Mm.
And what that means is on a stage, you will obviously have the two sides and you'll have the background, you'll have the set. On a film set, the same thing. You'll have the sides of the set, you'll have the background. But then what you're facing, will be either an audience or will be cameras. You can't actually have all four sides of a set because you need somewhere for the cameras to be. And so Howard Fine teaches, he said, you have to not just ignore the fourth wall. He said, you have to actually supply what's beyond the fourth wall. And so he teaches that you don't just say a generic, oh yeah, that's the other side of the lounge room. And I've seen him in class, he'll stop and say, okay, well, what does that wall look like? And the students will go, okay, well, it's a brick wall. It's not painted because it's in New York. There's a window up in that corner. And he's like, what's outside that window? And they go, okay, well, I can see this building and I can see this specific thing. And he says, okay, well, can you see trees? Yes, I can see trees. And then he'll go back to step two. Okay, it's in June. What do the trees look like right now? And he'll literally make them just create all in their imagination this entire place and this entire fourth wall. Because he said, what happens then is when you're delivering the lines and often you're talking to someone, but you're looking out this way, he said, don't just look to the audience. He said, you have to think, I'm actually looking directly at that tree and I'm seeing the tree and it's dead because it's June and it's in America. And I'm looking at that tree whilst I'm listening to you. And he said, what happens is that not only does it help you stopping from getting sort of breaking character by seeing the audience and suddenly go, oh my gosh, I'm an actor on stage.
Yeah.
And you sort of lost the illusion.
Mm.
But he said it'll actually help you focus beyond it and it'll help reinforce this life that you're trying to live as an imaginary character. And what God said to me, he said that same thing. He said, you have to supply what you can't see with your natural eye, but you have to supply it so that you can be in a place where, like you said, there's a whole lot of unbelief, there's a whole lot of fear, but I actually go, I can actually see something and no one else can see.
Yeah,
and I good. Can actually see a place of faith. And it's not, and because sometimes, you know, in film, they say, oh, just don't look at the camera. Don't look at the camera. That's all you need to do. And the first thing you do is you look at the camera.
Yeah. It's like the sun.
Yeah, don't, whatever you do, just don't look. And I remember the movie Little Rascals. There's a great scene of, at the end of the movie, they had all the bloopers. And like, God bless her, the little girl, I think Darla, was that her name? And there's just this recurring scene where they're just like, don't look at the camera, Darla. She goes, and they go, honey, don't look at the camera. She goes, yeah. And then the whole bloopers, they just kept going back to it because obviously it was a very recurring thing for her. And it was hilarious because no matter how many times I said, don't look at it, all she would do would be look at it.
Yeah.
And I know for me, God spoke to me, he said, sometimes the symptoms, sometimes the bills, sometimes the storms are that camera. And you just say, just don't look at the storms. And then you look at the storms. Just don't focus on the symptoms. You focus on the symptoms. And it's kind of, the more I tell myself, don't look at the symptoms, don't look at the symptoms, don't look at the symptoms, all I can see are the symptoms.
Have you ever been in a room and said, ignore the sound of the air conditioner?
Yeah.
Now all I can hear is the sound of the air conditioner.
I can't hear anything else now.
Yeah, but that.
I've been attuned to that, you know?
And so what this concept of providing the fourth wall helps, it means instead of saying don't focus on the audience, it's actually saying look beyond the audience. The audience is there. Yes, of course you're always going to be aware of them.
Yeah.
Of course there's going to be hundreds of camera crew, but you can actually say, but I'm actually looking beyond them to what I as the character need to see. And so we can say, okay, well, where am I? I'm in a place of faith. I'm in a place of victory. I'm in a place of healing. I'm in a place of miracles, all these things. And I go, oh, yes, I can see all the different cameras from all the different storms, all the different things, but I'm actually looking beyond them. And then you have to supply and be specific. That's why with Howard Fine, it's not just it's a wall. It's, okay, are there any photo frames on the wall? Are there windows? What's outside that window? Is the paint cracking? What color is the paint? Because the more specific you are, the easier it is to actually hold that, you know, imaginary image in your mind.
Mm.
And so for us, it's saying, okay, I'm not just saying I'm looking beyond the symptoms to seeing healing. It's a, be specific, what is that healing? What does that healing look like?
Yeah,
so suddenly a symptom, that's the really camera good. Is right there, but all I can see is this detailed picture of my healing.
Yeah.
Suddenly, and you know, it's amazing when you realize with the close-ups in film, like when you see behind the scenes, it is so intrusive when you see how close the cameras are and there'll be lighting guys and everyone's surrounding this one person who's meant to be talking to a group of people and yet there's all these people in their face. But this is why it's so important. Sometimes the closer the camera gets, the stronger you need to go, actually, I'm just looking beyond it and I can see exactly what's beyond that. And so now, where am I? I don't have a camera in my face. No, where am I? I'm in this location. I can see the windows. I can see the park outside the window. Yeah. I can see the restoration in this family. I can see the growth in this church. I can see where we're going. So even as the camera is getting closer and closer, that doesn't change. Yeah. I don't change my performance because I'm going, oh my gosh, it's getting closer. Don't look at the camera. Don't look at the camera. Don't look at the camera. And say, oh, I don't care how close the camera is. All I can see is what's beyond the fourth wall.
You know, that's one of the key principles that's really helped in terms of when I'm praying for the sick is being able to actually take an image of what God sees and what God says.
That's
and
good.
And six people say, come up, let's use the example of ankle, because we're talking about Jay. I've hurt my ankle. It's in a lot of pain. They might be even on crutches.
Yeah.
And so people come and say, oh, can you pray for healing? And so some people would say, Lord, heal their ankle. And you'd say, well, there's nothing wrong with that prayer. But that's sort of just responding to where you are. But what we want to do is release our faith.
Yes.
So we say, where am I?
Yes.
We sit here and we say, okay, what can we see beyond this place? We can see the right now, but we're looking beyond that.
Yeah.
And this is not just, in this Howard Fine, we're using the example of an imagination and how that works. We're taking this to, we're seeing in our spirit.
Exactly. What the mirror tells us.
Yeah, we're looking into the Word of God. We're looking into the Spirit. And so when I'm praying, I'm saying, Holy Spirit, what do you have us see?
Yes.
What are we looking at? And so, and I do this when I'm praying for myself. I do this when I'm praying for others. I begin to speak what I see.
That's good.
And it's like, I see you walking. And you can put examples on. I see you carrying luggage and walking around individually. I see you dancing before the Lord. I see you and actually in my spirit seeing them do these things and praying. So I'm not just praying, heal. I'm praying for where this is going and what, and I'm actually, it's almost like you're giving this ankle a direction.
Yeah.
This is what our expectation is.
Exactly.
This is what we're going to be doing. And so we say things like, I see you twisting and turning without any discomfort.
Yes. Yeah, that's good.
Because some people just heal my ankle. What does it look like for an ankle to be healed?
Yeah, it's not just a wall. It's what does that ankle look like? What is it? Yeah. Be specific, be detailed.
And some people say, my ankle's not hurting. Yeah, that's good. But a healed ankle allows you to do extended twisting and turning without any discomfort, not even pain, but because it's really healed. So we're pressing through and we're believing God, and I say we see it pain free. And so we engage with the people, and the idea is it's not just my faith, your faith needs to be quickened, and you need to be sort of seeing that, and that's sometimes you hit a bit of a this is what I'm believing, and they're like And they immediately say, no, let's reframe the world to what I see.
Yeah.
And let's bring it back to a bit of reality here, Pastor. Do you know what I mean? If I can just take two Panadol and, get through the day, I'm fine. All right, that's all you can see.
Yeah.
Well, I'll get in agreement with you that your ankle feels better and that those Panadol work. Because I will, sickness, no one wants it. And God is, God is against it. You know what I mean? And so if that helps you and brings some relief and allows the natural healing of the body to work, good. I'll get in agreement with that. But if you're framing your world, it's like, okay, but what I see, so how much better when it's like, let's work together.
Exactly.
I remember Claire many, many years ago when we were in the old building, she came in, I think she had crutches, she rolled her ankle, and I was praying for her. The meeting was, we stopped to pray for people, but she was at the front row, and I remember it very clearly because the meeting went on, but we kept praying and believing like 10, 15 minutes. And I remember actually one person, I'm reading something, so one of the healing ministers, they said one key thing for them was people just pray and move on.
Yeah.
They say, sometimes you've got to spend time in prayer, but there's no time. We have prayer.
Yeah.
And so they made space where people can go to the side and just continue in
that's really powerful.
Prayer. And can I say, if you're in church or at our church or anything like that, and you come and you want prayer, well, you don't have to go back to your seat.
Yeah. All right, we pray stay for and you. Continue pressing.
Go to the side and just get down and really pray. And if you want to, just say, someone, can you just stay with me? Really agree with me. Wow. It'll be like,
yeah.
Because this person is saying, because what I see, I'm locking into, and I'm not doing this. And so with Claire, she'd rolled her ankle. She was, I think she was on crutches. She was, and we began to pray. But we were doing this. We're saying, I see Claire walking and dancing without, you know. And at the start, there was none of that. You know, she was in a lot of discomfort. She couldn't put weight on it.
Yeah.
But I really appreciate she locked into it, and she was begin, and she, you could see it. She was just praying, and she's declaring, and I'm standing there, and I'm declaring, and she, and she's like, you know, I'm going to get up. I'm going to do some walking, because that's what I can see myself doing.
Yes.
And I can, and so she began to pray, and she, and by the time that 15, 20 minutes, I don't know how long it was, in the end, she walked back to the seat, you know, without, you know, but it wasn't like that.
Yeah.
But we, you create what, where you are in terms of, this is what I see, this is what,
this is the reality,
because it's got, and it goes in the face of, this is what's normal, this is what a normal, you know, you've got to say no, that this is my environment, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
My space and where I am, this is normal, this is normal talk.
Amen.
This is El Shaddai talk. We're speaking, we're declaring healing and wholeness and strength, but we're envisioning it, and we're talking to it, and we're speaking to it. And we're declaring, you know, and often one of the techniques God's, you know, helped me with is sometimes you're dealing with people, when they're in pain, you can't see pain.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? I can see movement, but I can't see when someone's like, you know, my shoulder aches, you know, when and so what I do is I ask them for a number. I said, zero is no pain and 10 is excruciating. What's your pain level at the moment? And sometimes, you know, they look pretty blank face. They say 9. Okay, you're really suffering, but you're not letting anyone know.
Mm.
Do you know what I mean? But the reason for that is because I'm setting my faith for a 0.
Yes.
So I have to have something tangible to set my faith on.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And so, and to be honest, you know, if someone says, oh, I'm not in pain now, it's only when I do certain things. Okay, I've got to reset my faith because I'm praying for no pain. You're in no pain.
Yeah.
It's only when I wake up in the morning.
Yeah.
Okay. Or it's only the other. But if they say 9, okay, we're believing for 0 pain. Jesus took all our pain. And then we say, what can't you do? Or, you know, I can't lift my hand above my shoulder.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Let's believe God. So if you had 0 pain, and you put your hand above your head, we would know that God had healed it.
Mm.
Right?
Yeah.
So then we zero. Lord, I thank you. We can see a shoulder that's free of pain. I can see an arm that's moving.
Yeah.
And sometimes I'm doing the action. You know, I'm praying. Yeah. Lord, I can see an arm that can come up here and wave around. And Lord, we can see that pain just dissipate. We can see, and you know, and then it's like, you know, Jesus said, take up your bed and walk. Do something.
Yes.
Go to this. Do. So, you know, lift your hand and lift your arm. So you begin to see it, and they begin to do it. And then because I can't see pain, I say, now what's the pain level?
Yeah.
What's the pain level? You know, and you know, expectations 0, and they say 7. Well, let's come down.
Yeah, keep praying.
Keep praying. And I don't get too upset. Like, oh, still 7. No, it's even if they say still 9. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's okay. We know that we're targeting something.
Yeah.
Really, you know, and I remember Richards, who's watching, and I've mentioned this before, you know, I remember testimony again back in the old building, and God told me God's going to heal Richard. He'd had neck pain and he'd had, you know, been very, for a long, you know, like I had a camera, it was, you know, extended period of time. And God's like, he's going to get healed. And I called him up. I had such confidence because I had the word of the Lord. And I said, Lord, you know, what's Richard? And prayed for him and felt the power. I felt the glory.
Yeah.
And I said, Richard, you know, what's the pain level? And he said the same. And I'm like, it was like, no! I was just so expectant. And he said the same. So I prayed again. And this time, all the feeling went, you know, like all the anointing went, there was just nothing. But what I was doing was framing it purely in where am I?
Yes.
And we are in faith and we're believing.
Yeah.
And I felt nothing. I felt, and Richard looked at me and goes, all the pain's gone.
That is amazing. God is so good.
Yes, amen. And, you know, Claire walks back and people, and I've seen people, and they go, and it goes 9 and 6. But often people get to about 4 or 3. And because they've been in 9, 3 is... just, we can live with 3. And it's like, we're not pressing in for 3.
That's good.
You know what I mean? I wasn't seeing 3. Now if I hadn't seen 0, we might have stopped at 4 or 3. Because it was we're praying for improvement. We weren't praying for improvement. We're praying for 0.
That's so
good. We're praying for 0. And so often they say, oh, it's down to 3 or 4, you know. It's just, I say, well, that's good, but we're going to keep praying.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, rather than that's good, send you back.
Yeah.
It's like, well, we're just going to keep praying because I'm not here. I didn't. We haven't set our focus on, you know, minimal, you know, less pain.
Yeah.
We've seen no pain. We've seen you be able to do this with no pain. We've seen and that's why I said no discomfort or no ongoing ache, and you know, because you don't want to even, you know, you don't want to see people, you know, free from pain while I'm praying for you, and then, you know, they walk away and they got the aches come back, you know, the next hour. And, you know, so we've got to stand, you know, because these things need to be held onto and resisted and get an agreement. But whilst we're there, we can get an agreement. And then it's like people go, oh, it's totally gone.
Yeah.
And it's like, amen. But without this focus on what we're looking at, what we can see, and being very specific about it, in the light of what God has said, in the light of what He's saying.
What He's
promised. Like I said, this, where am I? Is flying in the face of our normal cultures and our natural, and you know, and what feels comfortable, and it can, you can do it. And I, you know, I said, you know, I've shared this before. One of the most uncomfortable times is when we had a lady, an elderly lady, husband and wife, Christine. You remember their names?
Betty.
So yeah, Hal and Betty, and you know that they. Like in the 90s, I think, 80s and 90s, and she was older. She came in her arms in a sling because she'd fallen and hurt, damaged her collarbone, and she's arms there. And the Lord said, go and pray for her. And so I didn't call her out. I just went to her seat. So she was sitting there towards the back, and I'm praying and was saying, Lord, you know, let's believe that Betty, you can do this, and you can, you know, put your arm up and all the rest. And then the Lord's like, now, what do you see? What do you do? And it's like, well, you know, you asked Betty to...
Yeah.
Do something. And the natural says, that's not where I am. You know, where I am, you take care of the elderly.
Yeah.
You take care of the frail.
Yeah.
You don't cause them to do things that cause... You know, it's like Elijah when he was told, you know, go and tell that widow, prepare the last meal for you.
Yes.
And then you can have the, you know, the Lord will provide for you. It's like, well, I'd prefer, Lord, can you provide the abundance and then I'll have a meal?
Yeah.
You know, I'm asking a widow and a son to give me their last.
There's a way to do this, God.
Yeah.
And so things that God tells us to do often push against our natural where I am. And they say, no, this is where I am. This is the conference. So, you know, and so this is all internal and I'm just letting God work. And I say, Betty, you know, we're believing you. And the other thing, and God taught me, this is through Kenneth Hagin, don't ask. Don't ask, can you do this? See if you can do this. Yep. I'm just praying. You've got to speak to what you see. So I don't say, let's see if you can lift it without pain.
Yeah.
I say, Betty, lift your arm without pain.
That's good.
Betty, move your arm. Yeah. Because we're speaking to what we see, not to... And because often we can undo stuff just with it, you know. I'm praying. That's why I don't say, is the pain, you know. I say, what's the pain level? Because I'm asking for a number with the expectation of zero. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
but,
that's
you know,
good.
But I'm not saying, has it worked?
Yeah.
I'm saying, what's the pain level? Because I can't see that.
Yeah.
But if it's an ankle, I say, put some weight on it.
Yeah.
I say, put some weight on it. Because, you know, we know you can't put some weight on it. And that's, you've got to be in agreement and you've got to release your faith. Yeah. And Betty goes, she takes the thing off and she goes, oh. And I can tell you, I felt this big.
What have I done?
Told you, God. You know. She goes, oh, there's no pain. Oh, there's no pain. All right, you could have led with that, Betty.
There's a way of saying that, Betty.
You don't wait 3 hours before you say there's no pain. You say, there's no pain.
Yeah.
But she was, oh. And I honestly thought that she was, you know, aching.
Yeah, but it's so powerful, it's what you can see.
Yeah.
And, you know, this is what separates amateur actors to the greats, the Academy Award winners, is I remember hearing an interview with Michael Caine, and he said often when you're talking to someone and they're what they call off camera, so meaning the camera's here, the person will stand right next to the camera, and so the camera is just focusing on you saying the lines to the person. And he said, so the person off camera, the actor will just sort of be standing just next to the camera operator delivering the lines. And he said, I've gotten to the point where I usually just send them home. And he said, it's nice for them to go have an early night sleep because he said, I don't need them there. He said, I can just do the lines saying their words back in my head. And he said, I've gotten to the point where I could deliver the lines to a brick wall. And he said, it's actually fine. I can.
Because he's seeing them.
He's seeing. And it's kind of that amazing point where you go, this is what makes them the greats, is they've sort of developed their craft to the point where not only is it, okay, can you imagine, I know the wall isn't quite what it is, but yeah. can you imagine the frames? It's a, there is no wall, there's no actor, but I can still see it. He has so developed the craft
yes.
of picturing what he needs That's to good. See as that actor,
yeah.
that it means he's kind of that self-reliant of, he doesn't need the area around him to be perfect for him to perform. And it's that same challenge for us. It's, okay, we look at the great faith giants. We look in the yeah. Bible. We look at the people we know, like Brother Copeland, Dr. Seville. They, what they have done is they have developed that point where they can see things which yeah. even other actors go, how can you be so detailed with this wall?
Yeah.
Say, well, no, because you develop it. It's something yeah. you develop. It's a craft.
I lived in this and I just see myself. This is who I
exactly.
am. This is what I do. This is what I, it just becomes, that's what we do. I remember Brother Copeland and Miss Gloria were sharing when they, God had told them to start doing TV broadcasts. Yeah. And that was a huge thing, and they didn't have the finances. They weren't near, you know, yeah. when God told them, there was no way. And but they said that was a project where they began to talk and they began to read and they began to confess and began to declare it. And they said they're actually, I think they stopped somewhere, on a, you know, like a truck stop on the way to a meeting, and they were talking about TV. And they said, and it just came to the point that it just tipped, just sort of tipped over, and I was like, well, we should just start. We should just do it. And it was not like, oh, we're gonna. It was like, their faith was, well, what's stopping us?
That's so
they
good.
Just, now they saw themselves doing it. Their faith was there. It was not like the finances had changed.
Yeah.
They weren't saying, oh, we've got enough money yeah. in the account now. When God told them, you're going to go on TV, they couldn't see themselves.
Yeah.
Because they couldn't see, how could they do it? They don't have the resources. They don't have the finances. They don't have the ability. They don't have the staff. They don't,
yeah.
All they could see is what they, you know, they say, God's told me, oh, we are, but we can't see it.
Yeah.
But then they got to the point where they can see themselves on TV, because that's what God had said, and it becomes such a part of their conversation and their focus and all the rest. And then it's like, well, why aren't we on TV?
Yeah.
You know, because that's what we are. God yes. said we are. And it just become, they had framed where they are based on what God had said.
Yeah.
And then it just came the normal thing. Well, that's just, so they weren't sort of stepping out in faith in that sense. Oh, you know what some people say, stepping out of faith means, oh, you're just taking hope to see that, you know,
yeah.
stepping to see what happens. It was like, no, they could see it.
Yeah.
They could see it. They were just doing what was
quite natural, so good.
And normal for them. I've got a question. I think we should just finish. We're only going to do step three. I don't think we're doing more today. But this is a question. Have you ever been in the natural, been somewhere where you just feel out of place?
All yes.
right? You know, you sort of like, you say, okay, I'm in the parents' lounge room where you just sort of awkward, you don't even feel you can ask, can you turn that air conditioner down? I'm freezing. Or people ask you, have you ever been somewhere? And some people are like, you know, those people are like, no, I don't have any problems. I just, you know, can you turn something, I'm cold, just turn the air conditioner down. And other people are like, I know exactly what you mean.
Yeah.
You know, people say, would you like something to drink? And you say no, even though you're really thirsty. Yeah. You just, I don't want to be a bother. You know,
yes.
I don't want to be. Yeah, so, you know, tell me if you're one of those people that when people say, do you want something, you say no instinctively, even if you're desperate for it, because you just don't want to, you know, I don't know, I just said no because I don't want
to
be.
That's why we're grateful to have Nadir around. Yeah, well, I am hungry. Food would be great.
Yeah.
Nadir was fantastic. We're very grateful for Nadir.
So
that there's
people that just feel comfortable in that situation or just don't care what others think. You know, it's like someone brings something. Sometimes I'll be like, oh, I want this change. Other times I will eat this stuff and I don't care if it's the wrong one. I don't care if this is the mushroom pie that the person is from the wrong table. I'm eating it because I don't want to create a fuss. You know, I don't want to.
Yes.
But have you ever been somewhere you feel I shouldn't be here?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And it's worse when you think you should and then you realize you're in the wrong place. You're sitting in a classroom.
Yeah.
And you suddenly realize, I'm in the wrong class.
Yeah.
I'm in the wrong place. Or I'm in a building. Or I've gone past and I shouldn't have access here. And then people are looking at me, security looking at me.
Yeah.
And you just feel so awkward. And you feel you've got no boldness. You got no confidence.
Yes. Yes.
And so we desperately want to be in a place where we feel comfortable. Now, in the Bible, I want us to get around our head what we are. You know, we're in this world.
Yeah.
Mm.
We're born into this world. We're a part of the world.
Yeah.
Yep.
If you go along with the world, everybody loves us. You know, in a sense of, you part of the zeitgeist. You go along with the flow.
Yep.
You know, you don't stand out. You just be one. Yeah. Be one of the masses. It doesn't mean your life's good, but you're one of the masses, and you're all going down the broad road together. Bible says to us in Philippians is that our citizenship is in heaven, from whom we all wait for a savior. In other words, we don't belong here.
Yeah.
We've been reconnected to a citizenship in heaven. Yeah. All right. So there's a point where we don't actually belong. But do we want to feel like we don't belong? Because not belonging is a very awkward sort of place. And what are we doing here on earth if we don't belong here? What are we doing here if we don't belong?
Yeah.
Well, our citizenship is here, but we're here as an ambassador, as a representative of God to get what he wants done for the earth done while we're here. Mm. So we are appointed So, no, I don't belong here, but I've been given authority and told to be here.
Yeah.
All right? You're not part of our class. What are you doing here? Well, the principal has told me to sit in this class and make some notes as an observer.
Yeah.
So even though you think I don't belong and I don't feel like I belong, this is actually exactly where I should be.
Yeah.
And I sit here with all confidence and boldness because I've been told this is where I should be.
Yeah.
And I think there's a point where we've got this dual thing. We're in this world. We don't belong in this world, but we should be here for this moment.
Yeah, exactly.
And we have authority to be here, and God's given us a purpose to be here. And I think getting that clear in our head, because otherwise we don't know how to behave. You know, do we belong or don't belong?
Yes. Yes.
Am I part of this world or not part of the world? And a lot of Christians they're sort of between the two.
And I think for me, one of the things that, God really spoke to me about when I was going through these 8 steps from my own personal faith journey, and the greatest revelation I got from the Where Am I was that concept of every location is under someone's authority. So, the restaurant, your friend's house, my house. The difference is where I'm someone and I feel I have an authority, I have a right, this is where I should be. And, there's a scene in the movie Crazy Rich Asians where the couple, they get on this flight and it's first class, and she's kind of freaking out because she's like, we're not first class people. How are we flying first class? And he kind of makes a comment about, my parents took care of it. And so she's feeling very out of place, and he's kind of in a way the same because they're just very easygoing people, and yet here they are in this first class flight. But what you discover later in the movie is that his parents are actually like gazillionaires, and he is going to inherit all the money. So the whole film is that she doesn't know, she just thought he's an everyday guy, but he's actually from not just a place of wealth, but extreme wealth.
Mm.
And I think, suddenly using that as an example, you could say, this is awkward for them to be here because they shouldn't be here. This isn't their scene. But the difference is that there's a piece of information that others don't know, which he knows, which means he's like, I actually do have every right to be here.
Yeah.
Maybe you think this isn't where I should be, but there's something I know. Mm. It's like, I have a secret. I know a piece of information from later on in the script, which you don't know, which is my dad owns this airline.
Yeah.
Okay. So suddenly, instead of a, where are the outsiders? It's a, actually, we do have the authority here. Mm. No, they just don't know it yet. Okay, we're having a fight in a restaurant. That's so inappropriate. Actually, I own the restaurant.
Yeah.
So there's that point where maybe the other patrons think it's awkward, but I have every right to have this conversation here.
Do you remember the movie Sherlock Holmes with she meets this guy in a big, really fancy restaurant full of people because she thinks there's safety here.
Yeah.
Because, nothing will happen in this public place. And he gets up and he taps the glass or something. And everybody stands up and walks out. In other words, he was in a restaurant, but everybody there was his employee.
Yes, exactly.
He booked out the restaurant. So he could do what he wanted because they're all, this is what it's about, a bunch of randoms. He'd made control. And it's like, you're in this space. You have to see, but my dad has told me to be here.
Yeah.
My father, God, who owns his world. And, this is the devil's world. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. The Bible talks in Ephesians is the prince of the power of this world.
Mm.
All right. But he's been defeated.
Yep.
And we go over and over, you know, we've been teaching this, you know, from Psalm 2. Jesus, one of the things he did as a part of his work on the cross, he asked the Father for his inheritance, which is all the peoples from to the ends of the earth as his inheritance.
That's good.
So when we're here and we are going and we're witnessing to someone, we're ministering to someone, we're not, oh, I shouldn't be here. It's like, no. Bible says you cannot plunder a strong man's house unless you first bind the strong man.
Yeah.
Then you go and take whatever you want.
Yeah.
All right? We're in a strong man's house. Mm-hmm. And people say, what are you doing here? Say, well, he's being bound. Yeah. I'm here to get the plunder.
Yeah, you don't know, but it's like you walk into a lecture and everyone goes, you shouldn't be in here. You're actually, you know, my dad's the head of the university. What you don't know is he got fired this morning. So what you don't know is he's actually already lost his job. And so therefore, my dad's taking care of him. So I have every right to be here.
My dad has told me this room is mine to go to and to do this. And I'm just here. And the people say, you don't belong here. Actually, I do belong here more than you belong here.
Yeah.
And so when we're in the situation, we're in this world, but this is not the world that the enemy has control over now. You know, he's doing his bit, but we're here as his God's representatives. And we're dealing with situation. We're not under that pressure. Mm-hmm. So I think part of that, where am I? You need to understand, where are you? You know, because otherwise it's like, I don't belong here. I shouldn't be here. I don't know where I am. And so you don't fit in the world, but you don't fit in the church. You don't know where you are. And you sort of got this awkwardness, and you're sort of trying to walk in faith, but you're trying to keep everybody happy. You're trying to keep your old self happy. Mm. You're trying to, you know, you got these two conflicting where am I's. This is where I am from my past. Mm. And God says, that's not where you are anymore. Mm-hmm. This is where you are.
Yeah.
And so, they conflict. Exactly. Now you're going to make a choice. This is where I am. This is, okay, we're at the bottom of a waterfall. In the natural world, there's a way to behave here. That's not where I am. We're the children of God. We're the sun placed. We're here with authority to call upon God. And we take a stand here. This is where we are. This is what we do. This is now normal.
Yeah.
And even though there was a natural sense where there was people coming on, and walking and saying, what are you doing? That's all right. We're just sitting here praying. And I'm going to pray because we've got kingdom business to do.
And it's like with Helen Mirren, you took that waterfall and you actually said, I'm going to set up my set here and I'm going to make this set a set of faith.
This is a set based around who we are.
Yeah. Exactly. And that's why all of Howard Fine's steps, all 8 steps, he said, the reason who am I is number one is because every step goes back to gaining information from who am I. So that's why even the where am I, the location, much of it is based on, well, who are you? So do you have the authority in this location? Yeah. Who are you? Are you new to this location? Who are you?
Yeah.
And in the same way, we look at the world, we look at our lives, and we go back to, who are we? Oh, actually, my thoughts, these are my thoughts. I have dominion over my thoughts. The enemy can't just be taking over my mind and my emotions and my imagination. Actually, no, this waterfall, okay, we're actually going to set up a little faith set here because we are now taking dominion over here because we have the authority to call on Jesus in this place.
Yeah.
It's, you know, I challenge you to go through and find all the scriptures in the Bible where it talks about the dominion and the authority we've been given in Christ, because it makes you realize, oh, it actually doesn't matter which diner I'm in.
Yeah.
If I have that understanding, I actually own this diner. Suddenly, I will walk in with boldness. I will walk in with authority. I will walk in feeling the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, because I'm not feeling as though I'm coming into someone else's dominion. I'm coming into someone else's space. You know, like the Lion King, it's all, they say, you know, when Simba went to the elephant graveyards, Mufasa freaked out. He's like, no, that's a place where we don't have the authority. That's why there are boundaries. It's understanding of like, actually, no, there are no places I can go because I have the authority in this world.
Yeah.
God has given us the authority. Yes, this is the enemy's world, but the enemy was defeated. And so I'm not going to walk around feeling as though he is still the one who's controlling my life. He's still the one who's controlling my thoughts, my emotions. He's controlling my family, my health, my household, my church, whatever it is. You go, actually, we have the authority.
Mm-hmm.
And so we need to be taking that authority. And so when we get to our prayers, when we get to our praises, we don't go, okay, well, how do I pray so that I can pray with boldness? How do I pray so it sounds impressive? Once you get that revelation of the authority we have in this place, we are in this world, but we're not of it. it's you go, okay, I actually just pray out and it just comes from this place of boldness.
Yeah.
I don't have to try to say, how does Michael Caine speak with boldness? It's because he understands all these things. So it just comes out as the character.
Yeah.
And we say, as children of God, it will just come out, that boldness. It will come out, that authority. We look at a sickness and we suddenly go, actually, sickness, you are the one who shouldn't be in this location. Yeah. This body, we have the authority over this body. We own this body. So sickness, we are telling you to get out.
Yeah.
We are telling you, no, you are the one here. This scene is us saying, okay, sickness, get out of here. You're fired. You're not to here, because this authority, we have the authority over this body. Okay, debt comes. No, we are casting the debt out because we have the authority over these finances. Strife comes. No, we're taking authority because we have the authority over these relationships, over these families. And so we cast out the things rather than us feeling as though we're just trying to navigate through without causing any commotion, because we shouldn't really be here anyway.
That's so powerful. I'm going to finish with one last thought, and then, you know, we'll talk about what's happening next week and following weeks. I was listening to a preacher. I'm trying to think who it was. I can't remember the preacher. It was a well-known preacher in terms of faith preacher. And he was at home with his child. And his child said, Dad, can you pray for me? And she said, but Dad, I want a church prayer. And so, and he said, suddenly understood. She says, I don't want a token prayer. I don't want the prayer that you just sort of give here. She says, I want you to see yourself as if you're at church. And someone's come for prayer.
That's powerful.
And you're releasing your faith and believing. Yeah. You know what I mean? She created the Where Am I?
Yes.
She said, we are in the kingdom of God church sort of
place.
That's good.
I'm not just at home getting a casual, I'll pray for you. And she said, no, I want the kind of prayer.
That's powerful.
I want the kind of prayer where you put all your faith in it.
Yeah.
Speak loud and speak, you know, at church. I, in the name of Jesus, I pray.
Yeah.
He said, I want that prayer. I don't want you one of your tokens. Oh, Lord, heal my daughter.
Powerful.
But it challenged him. So, you know what? Why is this?
Why do I have a church prayer?
Why do I have a church prayer and a home prayer?
Yes.
And I've been challenged. Often I get challenged at that at home, you know, because the kids come up for prayer or someone comes and he said, oh, Lord, let's pray. But really, you're sort of in your next activity almost.
Yeah.
So, like, you're giving them we're in agreement prayer.
Yeah.
But, you know, if I was at church, it was like, oh, I'll pray whatever I'm going. No, we're going to sit. And so there will be times, and I will on purpose say, I'm doing a church prayer. I'm doing the type of prayer where I am stopping and giving this, and we are kicking this thing out, and we're going to say, you know, what's the pain level? And we're driving this thing out, and we believe. And then one thing I've learned that so many times it just doesn't work in terms of normal prayer, because people don't ask anything afterwards. That's why I'm saying, well, they ask the wrong thing. They say, do you feel any better? I didn't expect my prayer to work, so I'm just is there any chance that God got you, even though I didn't expect? So you got, how do you ask but you stay in expectation, and you say, what's the pain level? Because my expectation is it's zero. And it's all, you know, lift your arm, what's the level, you know, do something. But many times people pray, they don't do anything else.
Yeah.
They don't say, well, what have we seen different, or what's the expectation? It's because, we don't have time to get it, you know. I just want you to give me a token prayer, and so we all feel good, but I don't have time.
Yeah.
No, if we don't have time to actually make this thing work, what are we doing? And also, that second prayer means I can actually, you know, that so many healings have happened because there's a process. I have certainly, my the level of people being, you know, I started to say, Lord, I do not want to pray for the sick. You say, that's a terrible thing for a pastor to say. Yeah. No, I don't want to pray for the sick. that's my catchphrase. I don't want to pray for the sick. I want to see the sick healed through prayer.
That's so powerful.
Right? You know, a lot of people pray for the sick.
Mm. Yeah.
That's just, you know, Christians praying for the sick is not unusual. I want to see people healed through prayer.
That's good.
Or through whatever, you know, God tells us to do.
And because that even goes into this concept with the 8 steps. And I know this has been a challenge for my life. So this is not me preaching to the choir. It's me preaching to myself.
Yeah.
It's, I would get so focused on how do I pray for the sick? And all my focus goes to my prayer, saying, how can I pray with enough power, with enough faith, with the right boldness, with the right sensitivity? Do I speak to the sickness? Do I ask God? Yeah. I don't need to ask God. I should just speak to it. No, maybe I should, but still. And I'm in the end, all my focus is on my prayer for the sick.
Yeah.
Whereas when you actually flip it to saying, okay, I'm seeing the sick healed. I'm seeing that fourth wall. I am seeing this person leaping and jumping, praising God. I'm seeing them up and running. I'm seeing them healed. Suddenly the prayer just becomes the way I'm getting to that point.
Yeah.
And so your focus once again is back onto God and what God's viewpoint is. And it also means with these eight steps, then God can actually lead you to pray in such a way where you don't expect it. And suddenly you pray with this authority where you just cast out that disease, or it's you actually begin to pray and you get a word of knowledge that you pray for them to release a bitterness in their heart because you suddenly understand there's actually an underlying thing that needs to switch. But those kind of things can only happen when you have got the right focus and you're heading the right direction. Yeah. Whereas for me, I would get so fixated on how do I pray, I would end up just, like with acting, I would just try all the different options for how to say these lines. And you suddenly go, oh no, suddenly, if I understand where am I, that is so dictating how I want to pray this prayer out.
Yeah.
And instead of going, okay, it's at a diner and now I just need to work out how I want to say the lines, it's like, oh, okay, I'm in a place of authority and now I'm just going to wait and see how my faith responds to this moment to pray. But it's not saying, hey, how do we pray for the sick? It's, okay, what's beyond that fourth wall? Let's just see how God's going to get us there.
Mm.
It's whether we pray, whether we actually just say, no, let's just worship, let's just praise.
Mm.
And suddenly there's endless opportunities and endless avenues God can use, which is the exciting part of faith. It's like, how are you going to do this, God? I don't know. But let's all go there together, rather than trying to figure out getting in the right way.
Yeah. So that's awesome. We're going to leave it there for you to meditate and think about where am I? I encourage you to maybe even think about, hang on a sec, I'm just at home. No, I'm in a place of faith. I'm in a place. Yep. And you say, what would it look like if I was praying and I was, at a believer's convention?
Yeah.
How would I pray differently? Well, that's where I am. That's my, I don't have to go to that location. This is my faith. This is my location. This is where I am. This is who I am. I'm going to pray.
Yeah.
Brother Copeland's on one side.
Yeah.
And Billy Burke's on the other side. We're going to pray for you and in the name of Jesus. Good. And I'm not going to stand back and go, I'm the one praying. We're all in agreement. And I'm just going to, because this is where I am. This is the type of mindset the I
location.
Have.
Location.
This is the type of faith I walk in. This is the type of expectancy. So anyway, we'll
can I just down. Like say one really quick thing for this is step four and beyond. One of the main things for step four, which we obviously won't look at today, but is all about the circumstances. It's all about the expectation in the scene. And I encourage you with this whole concept of where am I, so much of what we've said today about location comes down to what do you expect in a location.
Yeah.
If I go to a fancy restaurant, I'm expecting the staff to be kind and considerate. Yeah. So if a staff member is throwing a tantrum in the kitchen, the reason everyone stops and stares is because you don't expect that here. Whereas if you go to some random hole in the wall restaurant, you kind of expect that the husband and wife are having a huge brawl, and it's kind of of course, that's happening. But we've got $3 tacos. It's fine. We'll just eat them.
You expect it to be amazing Asian food.
Exactly. I'm expecting the food to be delicious. I'm expecting there's probably a brawl. That's fine. Whatever. And we say,
I expect the person to be watching a TV show while they're serving.
Yeah, exactly.
Not sure if what you're doing is sanitary, but the food's great.
But it's fine. But why is it that we use the example of believers convention? I go to a believers convention. I go to a conference. And I have such a faith and expectancy that God's going to move.
Yeah.
Mm.
Why is it that my expectation is actually saying, in that building? No, it's not the building. Yeah. It's the faith. It's the expectancy. Culture. Why? And, this is a challenge God's given me. He said, every time I come to church, he said, how can you increase your expectation? So every Sunday you're coming saying, this is the Sunday. Last year, Dr. Seville's here this Sunday. We're excited. This year, it was Brother Jesse. Yes, this is the day Brother Jesse's here. Why do I not come to every Sunday thinking, I have that expectation, God's going to move, something special is going to happen? Why do I not wake up every day in my house and say, this is God's house, this is God's location, I'm so excited to see what's happening? It's that expectation of, okay, if you can start thinking of conventions, of conferences, and you immediately expect there to be more miracles, that means you need to work on this where am I, and you need to redefine where you are, you need to reset up your set so that you can actually wake up every day saying, this is the location for miracles. You know, if you go when our family went to California, you know, many years ago, it's hilarious and so sad that we were, my sister and I were so convinced we saw so many celebrities, because every person, we're like, oh my gosh, it's the actor. And realizing they probably weren't all these A-listers, but because we were in California, we were just convinced there were A-listers everywhere. So we'd walk past someone, like, oh my gosh, I'm pretty sure that's Sean Bean. And later on, you realize it probably wasn't. But we so expected to be seeing A-listers simply because we were in Hollywood.
Mm.
I should wake up today saying, I'm expecting to see miracles. I am expecting to see turning points. I'm expecting to see turning points.
Where I am is in a place where that happens.
Exactly. Yeah, this is a location where miracles happen all the time. This is, like with convention, we go there and you expect there to be miraculous healings, because there are miraculous healings at every convention. There are these amazing moves of God. When Old Roberts would come with his tent, and they said they would have people who were given days to live and were completely healed. And that happened every time, because people came again and again expecting. They would bring all their expectation, all their faith to release at that meeting, because they genuinely believed there would be an anointing for healing.
Yes, that's good.
Why do we not say we wake up every day going, yes, I'm expecting today to be the day?
Yeah.
Because, okay, the big tent has come to town. Okay, Brother Copeland's come to town. No, it's a where I am. I just, wherever I go, this location goes with me. It's a place of miracles.
This is my place. I have authority to be here. God's working. I'm seeing myself. Mm. And I see some comments there from Christine about her place of authority, but also saying that, you know, Jay saw
John Travolta. I can guarantee that. He took a photo and showed us later, and the man did not look anything like John Travolta.
So that you've got this to work on now. Say, hey, where am I? What's my authority? Yeah. You've got to see this space. See where you are based on what the mirror of God says. See where you are based on who Christ is in you. See where you are and begin to
understand,
and have the confidence and the boldness there.
Mm. Yeah.
So we will continue this, because there's only there's a number of other steps. Some of the later steps are going to be sort of combined.
Yeah.
But we've still got some more steps to work through, which help us like this to get our head around who we are in Christ and see what we're doing it. Yeah. And it's just so helpful to get to shape ourselves, this is what we're doing, and do it on purpose. But next week, we've got a special guest, Greg Baker. I'm just making sure I got the name right.
Yeah.
Greg Baker, because he's an author that I've been reading over the last few months, an author in terms of Christian books, but novels, Christian novels. He's written a series for teenagers, which I've read, and some of the family members read. But he also did a series on David, looking at the life of King David over about, I think it was four different novels, taking his early life till the point where he became king, and then the novels stopped, which I was very disappointed for. And I spoke to him and said, you know, what about the rest? And he said, the whole dynamic changes. And he said, maybe in the future, you know, looking from the perspective of one of the other people, I'm saying, well, you know, just get on it.
please and thank you.
But okay, what happened was that I was really impressed with the novels, because they really did a good job of unpacking David, but staying true to it.
Yeah.
But also, you've got to fill out the whole life. So you've got to see yourself through the life of David, what he was facing, the challenges, the people around him, the cultural issues that he was facing, the difficulties that were there, everything. And I thought he did a really good job. And at the end of the book, he was talking about his way of, you know, how he approached the Bible in order to bring this story to life.
Mm.
And I was impressed by how that last section, I said, you know, I actually felt, I like that. That's how we approach the Bible.
Yeah.
This is sort of Breakthrough Academy. We go to the Word, we let the Word speak for itself. We don't just sort of go, oh, that's strange, and move on. We let the Word, expand and enlarge and talk to itself and give us wisdom and insight, but also for us to capture the reality of it and make it real for us, so it becomes a mirror, not just we're reading interesting stories.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So David becomes real, but in becoming real, you don't say, oh, I don't like what I see, but you actually can look beyond that and see the Word of God, and it gives you great depth. So I appreciate it. So I actually contacted him when I was preaching on Turning Point, because it was from the life of David and Ziklag, and I actually sent a comment on his author's page and said, you know what, your books gave me, you know, good feedback and background. So when I was doing this message, that helped and gave me some extra confidence in what I was doing. And so I appreciate that. And he actually responded back. And I responded. So we started, you know, sending a few emails. And I said, you know what, I would love you to come on Breakthrough Academy and share about how you researched for this book.
Yeah, amazing.
Look at your process for this. You know, what did you do? And, you know, how did you, you know, what happened when you, how did you understand the culture? What happened when you hit some snags? And he pointed out, for instance, in one, because, you know, you've got David's Life and Chronicles, which is from a different author and perspective. Mm. And you've got from First Kings, that's a different author.
Mm.
So sharing on the same stories in parallel. Mm. And in one story, it says there were 7 sons. And in one, it says there's 8. All right, so one has 8 sons, one has 7 sons. And David's like 1 of 7 or 1 of 8. How does he, what does he do with that? How do you respond to that? How do you go through, you know, so some of the challenge, which is basic, letting the Bible be a book, but letting it be God breathed. Then how do you go beyond that and capture the miraculous part of David's life and the supernatural part and the part that the part that gives you wonder and the part that gives you excitement, this part that stirs you, but also see it in the reality that sometimes we make Bible characters and we say they're amazing, we forget the real things they had to face.
Yes.
Because without that, we can't relate to them that, hey, we can do this because they did it. Do you know what I mean?
They were just human.
That's why Ziklag was like, he dug deep at a time when he was at the end of himself, but he dug into God.
Yeah.
That's the difference between him and Saul. So I want us to speak with Greg and pick his brain about the process he went through, but more about, not so much, you know, how do you write a novel, but how do you go into the Word of God,
read it,
research it? What do you do when you get some stuff that, you know, throws you some curveballs? You know, how do you respond when you find stuff happening, you know, culturally? There's a lot of death in the Bible, you know, stuff that, you know, my chicken, my food, I've never seen an animal slaughtered. Do you know what I mean? You know, because you know, we are so removed from any death in the Western society, whereas in a lot of societies, death is all around them all the time, whether it's animals or even people. That's just a normal part of what they experience. So, I'm repulsed a little bit when I'm faced with, you know, violent situations. How do you see that through their eyes? And, you know, you can get what God's
amazing.
So we're going to ask him lots of questions like this. How, you know, how did he go through this? What did he learn from David and things like that? What did, you know, what revelations did he get? And so I'm not exactly sure where it's going to go, but we're going to open those
it's
questions.
It's very academy.
And very academy. we're going to stir through
just
and
follow them.
And follow some of the Bible. We're going to ask him some of the questions. If you've got some questions about, you know, how do you do Bible study, or about David's life, especially in the first part, you know, once he became king. I'm not sure how much research he's done, but he certainly researched very heavily the first part. You know, some, you know, thoughts about that. You're welcome to bring those questions and ask him.
Amazing.
He's also done a series on Daniel, which I haven't read. He says, oh, he read my series on Daniel because he's done it later. So he's improved his, you know,
amazing.
His skill of it. So I said, oh, I'm going away on holidays. I'm sort of like, maybe I should keep those.
Yeah, definitely.
When I'm away. So I've got a series of books to
read.
That's
so good.
You know, if I get troubles on holidays, get a good book, I'm, you know, 8 hours a day. Like, I can read it. So, but yeah, he's got some other books there. So we can talk to him about that. So that's next Friday, live here. So he will be live from the States doing interview mode. And so it'll be Thursday afternoon for him, Friday morning for us. And come with your questions and we'll get to know him a little bit. And also understand a little bit, you know, let's pick his brain how we can understand the Bible better. And then following weeks, we will pick up on step 4, 5, and 6, okay?
So I thought we'd just leave it at 3. I was like, we've got 3 of the 8 done.
I do have this expectation things will move a little bit quicker because they're sort of foundational. But to be honest, we did 2 last week and we only one this week. So
that's true.
The where am I was longer than
the first 2.
first one.
Some great things there. So I'm enjoying it because it's making me think about who I am in Christ. From a different perspective.
It's amazing.
It's forcing me to look sideways and get better insight.
Yeah.
And so my thought is, like, I'm going to be more challenged. Like, when I'm going through things, where am I? You know, am I just letting this world shape?
Yeah.
No. I'm bringing I'm ringing. I'm the, you know, Inception. I'm the architect of this
environment. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I'm bringing what God so says good. About me here.
Yeah. It's been such amazing teaching. Like, two people can be in the same place and they can see something different.
So different. Yeah, yeah. So, absolutely.
That's amazing.
Yeah, that's true. People say, where am I? Two people can be totally different. Yeah. About that. All right. We're not going to get, we'll get caught up. Thank you so much.
You did not see John Travolta and Jay Lewis.
I did see John Travolta. Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'm sorry. What happens is this is all on Facebook. People watching from YouTube, like,
where is that car? Yeah. Okay. Jay Lewis is convinced he's seen John Travolta, is telling us, and it's not. It was not John Travolta.
If you've seen one of his movies called Face Off, you just had one of his other faces.
Yeah, maybe that's what Jay is thinking.
All right, I haven't seen that movie. It means nothing to me.
Different face was on him.
Okay. Your aim is to find John Travolta somewhere today in what you're doing. Thank you, Brooke. I appreciate that. It's been exciting to sort of use this concept to think about who we are and where we are and what we're doing. And we look forward to exploring that in weeks to come. Next week we've got guests.
Yeah, so good.
All right, so we will see you next Friday. At 9 a.m. Bless you.
Cool. Be blessed. Looking forward to next week.